a caregiver that we hired to stay with him, who was absolutely amazing, who ended up falling in love with the kids. You know, just she did such an amazing job. So they were held by all that. Yeah.
And a little bit about the support, again, on Facebook, all the people that supported, the fans and the friends and the fundraising. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
It was just overwhelming, you know, and it has made us able to take a year for Walter and really be okay with all the medical bills and everything that went on. But really what was so astonishing was to see people just come out of nowhere and hold us. I mean, it literally felt like an embrace. Every day I'd get up and there was new people who had donated, or there were people who had made comments on something I'd written. I never felt alone. And the most clear thing of that was during Walter's liver transplant operation, which was about 8 hours. It was Memorial Day, so there was nobody in the waiting room. He was the only one getting operated on, because it was just, you know, like there was nothing scheduled, obviously, for that day. And I was alone in this waiting room for 8 hours, and I posted throughout and had people respond. And whenever I would get an update from the doctors or the nurses, I would put that out there and people would respond. It was an amazing experience. So all this about, you know, modern technology and Facebook and the alienation that we suffer in our culture and all that, it can also be turned the other way around. I really felt we were so surrounded with the true goodness and gentleness.
So you and I talked a little bit about while you were, you know, going through this journey with Walter, you had to, especially when you went to Omaha, you had to wean some of your clients, your life coach clients, and that turned a little bit more to writing, which is what you're really excited about. So let's talk about that a little bit.
Well, obviously, it was difficult for me to set up shop, really, and continue much of my life coaching. So some clients transitioned out, we went through some things really quickly, and then I was able to finish up with them. So it was something I couldn't really continue during that whole process, and that was, you know, sad. But at the same time, it has opened up. Obviously, I was sitting there with Walter. I was at the hospital 12 hours a day most of the time. But it did open up some opportunities for me to write more, which is something I've always wanted to do. The thought for me has been, you know, I really think that that could be something that I can help other people with, because of this experience has been so extraordinary. And some of the thoughts that I had throughout it might be able to be helpful to others. So a book might come out of that at some point. That's my hope, for sure.
That's wonderful. And I hear something about a PhD.
That's in its qualitative data analysis phase right now, which is a lot of statistics, a lot of numbers, lots of coding, lots of just time-consuming stuff. So, you know, I'm doing that as well.
That's great. Now, the last time I interviewed you was at the Ventura County Beer Festival, and I really felt the teamwork of you and Walter. So if you can talk a little bit about how your teamwork has helped this journey.
We are so close. You know, we've worked together for 23 years. And we've been married, obviously, for 23 years as well, and together for 24. So we are almost the same person. And I could not imagine life without Walter. So throughout this whole process, it was really a matter of whenever he was giving up hope and giving up faith and just giving up because he was getting so tired of hurting and of being miserable and being weak and being in doubt and being in uncertainty and all those things. And every time he would go there, I'd sort of say, no, you don't. Nope. I would sort of pull him back. He needed to stick around for me and the kids. When he lost hope for himself and he lost faith for himself and he lost courage for himself, I really tried to tell him, well, I need you here. You know, if you can't fight for yourself, fight for me, fight for the kids. So I think us being so close and used to working together almost added an element of strength, in that my strength was his strength.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And, of course, his weakness was something that I took on me as, this is something we are going to fix.
And, you know, the community, the blues community, we've talked a little bit about that, how it's kind of wrapped around you, and, like you said, you have felt felt like you were being held by everybody. Tell me a little bit about that and your work with the blues and the blues community.
Well, it's a love thing, you know. It's, I mean, there's a lot of authenticity, a lot of realness, a lot of connection in the blues community. That's one of the things that's actually coming out of my dissertation that I'm doing on the blues, the relevance of the blues in the 21st century. And those are some of the things that we find in the blues. It's that very unique sense of community that bonds people on real things, not on the gloss and glamour, but on real, authentic connection to each other.